So now we go to building our own API. Let's assume for a moment that we've not found what we're looking for inside Office, and the cognitive services do a lot of what we want, but sort of not everything. Let me give you a good example of that, where you sort of run out of power in the cognitive services, at least at the moment. These things are constantly getting better. But we've got this idea of taking a lung disease prediction model, just using chest X-ray images. Now, X-rays are really hard to read. They're hard for doctors and technicians to read. So teaching a computer to do it is really difficult. But we got a blog entry here, and again, I'll send you to one of these. This particular one can actually take, I'll show you these services in a moment, can take an X-ray and can tell you if, in fact, the disease, or predict the probability of these diseases coming around simply by examining the information inside the graphic. And then you can see the deep learning network that this took using the DenseNet architecture. And we've got full information on that sort of thing, and shows you everything that's going on there. So some problems are not solvable with a simple call to an API. A great many are. So I still recommend you start with Office, you move to the cognitive services and the bot framework, and then perhaps you need to write your own. And if you do, we have a few things that can help you, both infrastructure and tools. So the first thing we have is Azure Machine Learning. Now, these are a set of services that I'll describe in just a moment that help you write your own and control your own APIs. In other words, you create the cognitive services that you just saw. Now, by the way, you can use these together. So within a single call, you may call out to the API for vision, and then you may call another API that you've written to do something further with the information. We also have the Azure Machine Learning Workbench, which is a sort of a control panel, a single pane of glass to look through everything. You can use IDEs like Visual Studio Code or Visual Studio or PyCharm. And then we have toolkits, the cognitive toolkit. It's similar to TensorFlow, if you want to think of it mentally that way. It's got some advantages that you'll see there, but we also allow you to use TensorFlow or just about anything else. Let's take a look at how these work. Let's start out with the Azure infrastructure itself. We have sort of three big areas. The first is AI on data. So Data Lake and Cosmos DB allow you to do artificial intelligence type algorithms across data. And then, of course, there's AI compute, including Spark, a data science virtual machine. In fact, the data science virtual machine is what I'm on right now, showing you this demo. We have batch AI, so you can send a group of information, have that processed, and come back out. To operationalize these things, it's always a good idea to have a container service, and this works with Docker, is what the technology that's underneath that. So we have a full scalable service so that you don't have to stand up Docker. We'll do it for you. You can also do that yourself. The data science virtual machine has Docker built right in. Now, one thing I didn't mention is a great many of these algorithms can be pushed all the way out to the Internet of Things. So if you've got a very small CPU stamp, let's say in a drone or other types of equipment that you would like to push out the prediction algorithm, many of these can be containerized such that they will run on those very small platforms. In the very first link I showed you with all the examples, there was an example there of a company that's using drones around power lines. Do these things need to be fixed? We've got, you know, hundreds of thousands of miles of line to cover, and how do we do this? And they send out the drones, and the drones using AI will predict, okay, this one needs to be worked on, and they'll only go to the ones that they need to inspect. Really useful. Now, on top of all this, we've got, or rather underneath all this, we've got a whole bunch of platforms you can use for the processing side. Standard CPUs, as you can imagine, and then specialized CPUs, things like GPUs. We have those available in Azure so that you can call out to a very powerful GPU to work with this stuff. But there's more involved in than just the infrastructure itself. There's coding, and then there's management. And one of the things I want to hit briefly is this team data science process. I'm going to cover that more in a moment, but that is very important and something that if you're on a larger data science team, you need to start thinking about. We also have Visual Studio tools for AI. That goes also in code, Visual Studio Code. We have the Azure ML Workbench. We allow you to use Jupyter Notebooks. I'll show you that, PyCharm, and so on. As far as the frameworks, we have the Cognitive Toolkit from Microsoft, but we support TensorFlow, Caffe, scikit-learn, Keras, Gluon, others that you can imagine. Pretty much if you can call it from within Python, we support it. Let's take a look at that team data science process. I've actually put the link up here. I've got all the links for everything else at the very end, but this one's very important, so I've kind of tossed this up here. Let me show you what it involves first. The data science teams of old were usually very small, one or two people in a room, very intelligent around machine learning and statistics and the domain knowledge within the business. And they would usually receive data from various locations, scrub that into some feature sets, and then create a model they would use and then deploy. Either they would deploy that for the users or very often create visualizations that would say, okay, here's our prediction, here's our classification, here's our reinforcement learning model, and so on. But as time has gone on, the work in this area has exploded. And so these teams are a bit overwhelmed, and they spend a great deal of time on more than just algorithms. And so they begin to pull in other team members, people who understand the business, people who understand data cleansing, folks maybe with a background in SQL Server or Oracle, folks that are very good at visualizations, Power BI and the like, and then people who are also familiar with software development life cycles, something they may not have always had to care about. So there used to be a process called the CRISP-DM, the CRISP, which was the cross-industry standard platform for data mining. It was an older platform. It worked very well, this process, but it was usually aimed at a very small team or even just one person. So what we did was we standardized that and expanded it, and we've got some assets around that that I'm going to show you in just a moment. But it involves various phases, and there's not many, and it fits well within the CRISP-DM. And in fact, this is not specific to Microsoft. You could use this for any data science project. We start out with defining your objectives and figuring out where the data is. We move on to acquiring that data and then maybe looking at it and uploading it. Maybe it's large sets of data, so you need to figure an ingestion pipeline and so on. Again, things data scientists don't really want to care about, bringing over tons and tons of data and all the plumbing and security and privacy issues and so on. Also, then we get into the modeling. We'll grab our features, and if that is if it's supervised learning, we'll grab labels as well. And then we'll create and we'll train various models. We'll then score those, and we'll create a final model that we would like to deploy. And that's exactly what we'll do. We'll then put that somewhere so that people can access it. But in data science, or in specifically in predictive models, you're not done. Once the application is deployed, you need to test it to make sure it's predicting correctly. And then you take those predictions and you compare them to something called ground truth. And you make sure that you don't get what's called model drift. And you need a way to retrain your model and also not just retrain it, but able to tell how effective it is in using that. Let's take a look at that. This is important enough for us to see. So let's pop over here and take a look at this. This is the team data science process feature that we have at Microsoft. I gave you that link. And if you come here, you'll realize there's a full life cycle. There's roles and tasks. We have project structures for you, project planning. There are examples. There are how-to in topics and so on. It is very, very, very robust. Tells you the makeup of a team, a standard team. It tells you how to create a Microsoft project or project structure. We have that available for you. We have the ability for you to clone the structure from GitHub, the resources you have available, and so on. We even have the roles and tasks that you might have. Let's say the individual contributor does the following things and so on. We have swim lanes for everyone and so on. This is important than it might originally appear. Those of you who work in data science teams, this hopefully is resonating with you. By the way, on any of our help documentation, you can simply click download as PDF, and that'll make for some light plane reading. I just got back from Lisbon, and the 11-hour flight that it took me, I got some good reading because of that feature. All right, let's get back to our slide deck here. the team data science process, as I mentioned, it is incredibly important, and it's a real feature. I highly recommend you go take a look at this, whether you're a manager, a developer, a data scientist, a data wrangler, a visualization specialist, any of those roles, you should definitely be familiar with what we have here. And we tell you how to do each and every step